Hello, and welcome to this 67th edition of Office Hours presented by Something Digital. My name is Tony Chiarelli. See, I remembered it then. Good job, Tony. Cheers to me. On the show today, we have Brian Serow and Brian Lange.
Hello.
Hello. How's everybody
doing today? What's going on?
Cannot complain.
What's new? What's new with you guys? I'll tell you.
So much is new. So much is happening. I feel like 2020 is just, it's different every day. You turn around and it's different.
It is. One thing that's new that we can't, you know, talk too much about, but Something Digital has been acquired. So that's awesome, by a company called Rightpoint, a Genpact company. We're still very new to the news here at Something Digital, so we can't say too much about it. But we all know that we're really excited. Anybody have anything to add other than sheer just fired up excitement?
Rightpoint's a good company. Our conversations with them so far have all been super positive. We like the team. We like everybody we've met. And these guys definitely have done some cool work. So yeah, I'm pumped to be part of this.
Yeah, me too. Incredible. Rightpoint's done such good work. It's really cool to be a part of a team like this.
Yeah, I want to emphasize what Serow said, and I totally agree with it, that we've met, you know, not an insignificant number of people at Rightpoint to this point, and everybody has been great. So it's something that we are so excited about, and we can't wait for what ends up happening in the future. But I'll kind of leave it there. I felt like we had to mention it, but like I said, not too much to report. Everything is moving along normally, I guess. I don't know. I've never gone through an acquisition before. It seems pretty normal to me, though.
Welcome to the club, Tony.
Exactly. So on the show, we are talking a little bit about 10/10 and Prime Day. And then after that, the New York Times wrote an article about curbside pickup and how important it's been to businesses during the pandemic. So we'll talk a little bit about that. So let's start with 10/10 and Prime Day. I think everybody knows what Prime Day is, Amazon's day for a bunch of sales, but what the heck is 10/10? I feel like I didn't know about it until after it happened. Does anybody know what this thing is?
I completely missed it, but it looks like it is the other retailers besides Amazon's attempt to make Singles Day, which for people listening who don't know, that is on November 11th in China every year, and they sell an unbelievable amount of merchandise. I think last year was something like $30 billion in the first, 2.5 minutes or something. The numbers were just preposterous. My brain broke listening to the stuff about Singles Day. So it's the retailers attempting to have a new shopping holiday here that's not controlled by Amazon.
So, okay. Maybe we need to back up a little bit too, because I've heard of Singles Day and I think I understand what it is, but it's just so far on the other side of the world that the only time people bring it up is when they say, oh yeah, Singles Day, of course. And I've never had the guts to ask the question of what the heck is Singles Day?
Now, Brian Lang, correct me if I'm wrong here, but I believe that this is also a made-up holiday, and I think Alibaba made this one up.
Aren't all holidays made up?
You could argue that, yeah. but this is a shopping holiday that they introduced, and it's become a huge deal.
Yes, and I think it's the deeper origins of it are that it was it was supposed to celebrate, it's like a little bit of a celebrate you day. That's why it's called Singles Day. And I could be wrong about this, but I think it was effectively to commemorate treating yourselves with gifts and presents effectively. It's yeah.
And it won't. It's
to celebrate being single effectively.
Okay. So that's Singles Day. We've established what that is. We've established what it means and that Alibaba, we believe, is the one that came up with it. Is that right? Or is that just a hunch?
I don't think that they actually came up with it, but I think Alibaba made it what it is, which is the biggest shopping day in China.
So now 10/10. which this is the first year that 10-10 has happened, right?
First year was on that radar.
Yeah, mine too.
Yeah, it may have happened last year. It still feels like it's not picking up the steam that I think whoever tried to start it hoped it would.
And there's no retailer behind it, to my understanding. It's just a shopping holiday that like a bunch of retailers have a bunch of deals. It's not like Prime Day, where Prime Day is specific to Amazon, right?
Well, right. A couple of key points, though. There's almost certainly some retailer behind it who got his buddies in other retail spaces. And keep in mind that Prime Day now has matching sales on certain places as well.
Okay.
Totally agree. Yeah. And I feel like, yeah, Prime Day like sort of co-opted whatever they were trying to do with 10-10, whoever that is. And I feel like just... My take on this is that the reason why Prime Day actually originally existed was to create an additional shopping holiday mid-year. And I know we're going to talk a little bit about Prime Day coming up here anyway. But to me, moving into October, whether or not it can coincided with 10-10 or, you know, getting closer to the holidays, or because they didn't want to have it during coronavirus, it felt a little bit weird, a little bit of a mistake. I haven't really had a chance to look. Prime Day just had finished yesterday. I haven't really had a chance to look to see if 10-10 or Prime Day had any effect on anything, like what expectations were and what actually happens. So I can't say if they were a success or not, but sure felt odd to me. And I spent less on this Prime Day than I've ever spent on Prime Day, only about one item.
I feel like it was definitely not as big of a deal this year, Prime Day. Like,
you are both wrong.
Am I wrong?
Huge.
$3.5 billion, 60% increase in sales from last year's Prime Day.
I guess this is just anecdotally, I remember hearing about it more in previous years, and it kind of crept up on me out of nowhere this year. And I didn't realize it was Prime Day until I went on Instagram and was targeted to go to Amazon for Prime Day. But
I watch a lot of Prime Video.
Could just be me being in a bubble.
Yeah, it could be you in a bubble. I watch a lot of Prime Video, and I definitely saw a lot of ads around Prime Day. It did feel like a shorter lead up time. And it's interesting. I do wonder if like holiday shopping at Amazon will actually diminish as a result of this being closer to holiday. Like I think it's possible the increase in sales has to do with the fact that it were like just a couple weeks, you know, or 6 weeks away from Black Friday, Cyber Monday, and people are doing their holiday shopping early. And that's how Amazon took advantage of this moment. And maybe it was a really brilliant play actually.
Lang, in the past, you have mentioned that you've considered getting rid of Amazon Prime. Have you actually done that, or you still have Prime?
Oh, I always say every time I consider it, I remember like how much I watch Prime Video, which is a lot. And so I can't.
You can't miss Marvelous Mrs. Maisel. That'd be crazy.
I know. That's exactly right. Like, What, Brian?
Literally haven't watched Marvelous Mrs. Maisel. I don't think I watch anything on Prime Video.
It's a
great show.
Really good show, and Prime Video has a lot of good shows, not to mention all the other content, like let alone original content. Like they've got a lot of great content on Prime. With kids, you know, I'm always looking for an edge on content.
Serow, what's your take on Prime Day?
I mean, I am a known Amazon fan. I actually went and pulled my spending on Amazon this year, and it tops out at $336, almost all of which was spent during the early days of the pandemic when you were just trying to get your hands on any good. I mean, Prime Day is a good idea. I agree with Brian that I don't get why they moved it to October. I do think, you know, having a shopping holiday in the middle of the summer, especially considering people tend to be busy on the 4th of July, was a good call originally when Amazon did it. The other greater problem with this is, Paul's more the consumers, so many businesses are competing with Amazon, and yet people then go spend their money on Amazon, which is probably competing with their business. So I think Prime Day should also serve as a reminder to people, like, if you're in any sort of physical good category, Amazon's probably competing with you now. And maybe Prime Day should be your reminder to spend less money on Amazon, not more.
Love it, Ryan. I love that take. I was just thinking about it even more. And I just, like, it's not something I've really spent as much time thinking about as I probably should have. And maybe to Tony's point, that because there was very little fanfare. Actually, I think they announced it pretty late.
Even. Yeah.
Like the one other thing I was thinking about is we're going to be approaching something that Future Commerce is jumping on the bandwagon. Well, it's not really a bandwagon yet, but we'll hopefully, I think it's going to be a bandwagon called Shipageddon. So I'll give you a little preview here. Shipageddon is going to be a huge problem coming up, because we've already seen increased lead times in delivery for e-com purchases. And we've seen a trend towards shifting channel from brick and mortar in-store purchases to digital purchases. This has been a big issue this year. It's going to take most of its effect coming up here at holiday. Because if we're talking about a 25% increase in digital purchases in e-com, our logistics networks were not built to handle this sort of influx, like immediate influx. They were built on very specific like steps towards growth in e-commerce. And so we could be looking at 6-week delay times for shipping, for holiday purchasing. So you might buy something on Black Friday online, and it might arrive like the day before Christmas. And so we're going to have to push people to buy online, pick up in store a lot more. It's going to be a lot of that going on, but that also presents a lot of problems coming up. And I'll get into that a little more, maybe not today, but I think maybe Amazon's recognized that they're going to have issues. We saw Prime issues have issues with shipping back in
March and April,
of COVID. So if they can capture holiday purchasing right now, instead of waiting 6 weeks till we get to BFCM, then I think that they're thinking, okay, like we're going to be able to get all this stuff to our customers. They're going to have the best possible experience and we win.
So I think that is a perfect transition into our next topic of this New York Times article specifically about curbside pickup, because one of the things that it mentions is the importance of Amazon's partnerships and acquisitions of Kohl's and Whole Foods respectively, and the importance of that footprint and the importance of the ability to pick up in store at those locations. So I want to start by talking a little bit about this article. Basically, what it says is that purchasing online and receiving goods in store, receiving goods at home, is more important, number one, and easier than really it has ever been. And yet, people are still buying online and picking up in store because people are so used to going to stores or getting in their car or whatever it happens to be, that it's just ingrained. And like, especially now that you can't really go into stores, people want to go into stores even more. So one of the things that you, Lang, have talked about quite a bit over the last couple of years is the idea, and you do say it jokingly at times, is the idea of the retail apocalypse. So with this evidence that companies like Dick's Sporting Goods are getting more and more people buying online and picking up in store just so they can go into the store, is the retail apocalypse real?
I think the retail apocalypse is way bigger than brick and mortar. It's not e-commerce, Tony, it's commerce. retail apocalypse had to do with a lot of brands that lost their way, technology doesn't solve all your problems. There's finances, there's brands, there's overextension of distribution, there's a whole bunch of things that went into the retail apocalypse, other than people not wanting to shop in stores. That was one little section of this, and I would argue that shopping in stores is going to continue to be a big part of what we do. It's not really about that. Now, meeting people where they're at, now that's something I can definitely get behind. I think that, you know, you do need to meet people at the, where they're, you know, in the channels where they're most comfortable, especially today. And so if buy online, pick up in store is that channel, then that, you know, that's something you need to do well, especially given that most stores are still at 25 to 50% of capacity in most major cities, or many, I should say. I don't know if it's most, many major cities. So I think that it's really, really important to consider that as we go into holiday shopping and we start to see lines outdoors, how is your curbside pickup set up? How is your in-store pickup set up? Are you going to make everyone that wants to get into the store that, you know, that wait in line with the same people that are there for buy online, pickup in store? Are you only going to have two parking spots available for curbside pickup? Or are you going to have to use your entire parking lot? Like, these are decisions that you're going to have to start thinking through right now when it comes to this holiday rush, because you are going to see people coming to the store.
Jumping off that point. So yeah, that's the experience that we're going to see for different retailers. You're going to see people complaining on Twitter about some retailer who does not deliver on this. But I am going to say something that I think is probably a little bit of a controversial take and probably not in the mainstream. I think the ultimate commerce experience, regardless of what happens 2 years from now, is buy online, pick up in store. Obviously, there are huge segments of the American population, myself included, who under normal circumstances don't have a car. So it's less than ideal for me to go get something. But for instance, when I was home at one point during the kind of like mid range of the first wave of the pandemic, I did buy online, pick up in store with Dick's Sporting Goods. It was amazing. I ordered something. I went and got it 3 hours later. I didn't have to worry about when it was going to show up. It was kind of a big item. They put it directly in the back of my car. And then I drove back to the house. It was incredible. That is the best possible experience. I get what I want when I want it. And I don't have to go in a store. I don't have to find the product. Someone does all of that stuff for me. That is, to me, a good trend that we're having coming out of this. And the brands that get this right are going to do very well. And it doesn't need to just be big retailers that can do this. If, you know, I've been seeing this, I've been doing a little bit of traveling through the Mountain West and in the socially distanced appropriate ways and things like that. And some of these smaller stores I've seen now have curbside delivery for your order. You just tell them when you're coming and they walk your stuff out to the car. So this is a huge opportunity, but it's also a huge threat if you mess it up.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. Because
that's really important, is the customer experience.
Yes.
One of the points that the New York Times makes is that the experience for the retailer in this situation is really important too. Because the number one, the most complicated, and number two, the most expensive thing about delivery is the last few miles. Because there's so many complications that go into finding a specific address, where if you have a great buy online, pick up in store experience, like Brian Serow is talking about, your margin ends up being higher too.
Yeah,
absolutely. It's a preferred experience for the retailer for sure. If you have the right systems in place, we saw initial implementations of buy online, pick up in store being incredibly inefficient. Thinking about grocery, when they first attempted it, they found that they couldn't do it. It was too complicated. So you do have to have the right system in place to make it achievable change management exercise for each store to accomplish. I think the back to your point, Brian, I think something you absolutely nailed is the fact that you, when you do buy online, pick up in store, you know you're going to be able to get that product. I think that's ultimately what I was getting at, is that buying online, having shipped to your house, is no longer a guarantee that you're going to have a product by Christmas or whatever holiday. It's going to be an undetermined, like, it's going to be a risk that you're going to have to make. Retailers that come out and message ahead of time about when you need to order by, and we've seen this in years past, but it's going to be something you're going to have to get even further out ahead of, because I think there's going to be a lot of risk for you as a retailer. You're going to hear one thing from your carrier, and then it's going to end up being something else. And so you're going to have to be really, really, really careful about how you message. And I would err on the side of conservative, way more conservative than you think you need to be, because you're going to run into bumps. I can't remember the exact quote from FedEx, but it was basically like they can't even guarantee their shipping times within a certain window anymore, like a window that you would have thought would be completely reasonable. So just be ready that you're going to probably have more customer service issues with buy online ship to home than you are with buy online ship to store. Like, that is going to be a big factor this year.
Two points off of this. One, there are certain businesses that are going to be at increased risk here for not just the delivery and what that means, but actually to their bottom line. Imagine that you're Sherry's Berries or one of those an edible arrangements type company, and you're sending fruit or chocolates across the country, and the truck goes from Seattle to Houston, and the chocolates show up 10 days late, melted, or that cake's gone bad, or whatever it is. These are very real risks, and these companies could end up having unprofitable periods due to refunds. Like, they might need to be looking at new insurance packaging or something like that that they can do to cover their butts, because this could be very bad for companies in certain spaces. The second thing, Tony, you mentioned the margin. I think this is hugely important. If you are a retailer with the physical footprint to be able to do this, whether it's regional or national, offer people $5 off to come pick up the product at the store. If you're going to eat margin on sending it to their house, but you can, you know, keep margin, offer them $2, $3, $4, $5 off per product they pick up, that's going to encourage people to do that.
Yeah, Walmart used to do this. If you picked up in store, they would actually give you a discount. I don't know if they still do that, but that was really, really interesting. Actually, to your first point, Brian, really quickly, Tony, I know you've got something to add here, but I would highly encourage retailers to look into technology like Route, because Route offers an Amazon-like experience for last mile delivery with insurance that your consumers can buy for transactions, or you can buy for them. So the beauty of this is, if it doesn't show up properly, it doesn't show up within the window that you're looking at, like, you're covered, the customer's covered, and Route takes care of that, one. And two, the experience, that last mile, like Amazon-like experience where you can see the truck coming on the stops, like that is just incredible. Also, like Shopify introduced something called the Shop app, which is sort of similar, although I used it and I wasn't like all that excited about it. It didn't seem like the retailer was taking advantage of the features or something to that effect. And I didn't really get the experience that I was hoping for. It certainly wasn't Amazon-like.
What was the so how did you sign up for that? Did you just...
You have to download an app. So right, I
know, but the reason I ask is because if you connect it to your Gmail account, it will go in to your email and like track shipments through that. If you just sign up through Shopify, you get a different experience.
Oh, interesting. I don't know what I did now. I thought I signed up through Gmail.
Whether it's through Shopify or not, because I signed up with my Gmail account.
Interesting. I thought I signed up through Gmail, but I'm not sure. I feel like this is, it's some, a tool that if like the merchant doesn't take advantage of it, or the carrier or something, like, it's not going to work the way you want it to. Not that, not that it's necessarily, I think it's a really good idea. I'm curious to see like how it ends up playing out. Route though, definitely go check out Route. Like, I think it's really, really cool.
I have to hit my quota of mentioning wine every time on office hours. And I have a couple, I have a couple wine shipments coming in the next few weeks. I swear to God, if they go bad because it's and like Brian Serow has me worried now after his fruit and chocolate story. Now I'm all worried. Like, I got to get Route. I got to get whatever. I got to get that thing here. And I got to get it here as quickly as possible because my wine will not go bad.
So a couple more points on this front, by the way. So I obviously big advocate of buy online, pick up in store, but there are some risks that retailers need to account for. The first, Brian, this actually, you kind of brought this back into my head. I remember some of the earlier days of grocery pickup, and Harris Teeter, which I love, I'm not throwing shade at Harris Teeter, didn't have enough space in the store near my university to be able to put that all somewhere. So there are these ugly kind of plastic wrapped offerings together that were just sitting in the front of the store, and it was an eyesore and hurt the experience of your in-store customers. Two, and the article did talk about this, and I think this is a huge point. In-store pickup is messy for your retail staff. They have extra work to do. There's a lot going on, and it can burn people out. Some of the bigger companies, there were always like these rumors that